that's one that we'll reach over.
Yes, sir.
Lay that book, and he'll say, no. You are not him. And it's my theology, it's my, but you can't prove it different. I believe that's when he himself will cast him into the lake of fire. That's the finality of a sinner. That day, I don't know what I preached last year. I may have preached here last year. But that day, as we stand before the great white throne judge, as we stand at the great white throne judge, not before the Lord, we'll stand with the Lord.
Right.
We will stand, we'll be there. Mm-hmm. Say, how you know that? Because when the Lord comes back, trumpet of God comes down, dead in Christ will rise, we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together in the air to meet the Lord and what? Forever. You won't be with him. So we're going to be there. We're going to be at the great white throne judge. We won't be before the Lord, but rather we'll be with the Lord. And we're going to watch as every individual is cast in the lake of fire. And I wonder if there'll be tears that day.
Oh, yeah.
I'm somewhere that says that there will be tears that day.
Oh, yes.
And you know why? Because I believe that's why it's not until verse chapter number 21.
Oh, that's right.
Whenever we find that the Bible says this, and God shall wipe away all tears. Why does he have to wait until chapter 21 to do it? Because we've just left the great white throne.
Yes.
And the reality of people being cast into hell that we could have influenced.
Yes, sir.
And I'll say this, you say, well, I won't know everybody there. No, we won't. But the fact of the matter is that we will know the reality that we could have been more.
Yes, sir.
Sometimes we get so pious and look how much I'm doing this, I'm traveling this many miles. Of course, it's that time, and we're filling out taxes and preparing taxes, and I have to figure out my mileage. And man, I look at that and I think, man, I almost 50,000 miles a year. Sometimes over 50,000 miles. Man, look what I'm doing. And we'll get that little attitude, man, I'm doing enough. I'm not. We're not. We could do more. He said, well, preacher, I can't do this and I can't do that. Hey, I'll be honest with you. I come to this realization, when I pastored my first church, there was a woman there that her body was racked with pain. And she couldn't even walk without braces on her legs and all that kind of stuff. And she couldn't door-to-door visit. She couldn't knock door-to-door visit. You know what she did, Brother Bud? Everybody gets junk mail. Oh, everybody gets junk mail. And most of the time in junk mail, what do you get? You get a little envelope. That's got a what? No postage necessary envelope. You know what she'd do? Every week she'd take 50 or 100 tracts home. And you know what she'd do? She'd stuff them envelopes. And she'd send them, put them in the mail. No postage necessary. There's probably more credit card application. People got the gospel because of her.
Yes, sir.
You say, well, she couldn't knock doors. She couldn't do this. But she found a way.
Yes, sir.
She found a way to get the gospel out. Why'd she do that, Bertrand? Why'd she do that? Because her heart broke for the lost.
Yes, sir.
I'm not being ugly. I'm not being mean. But can I tell you something? We go through service after service after service after service sometimes and never even use the altar.
Yes, sir.
Hey, man, I'm going to preach. I'm going to preach this. You mentioned it, man. I have to use. So that's between me and you. Maybe between both of us, we can remember this so I can write it down later. You got to talk about that supper, that Mary, Martha, and Lazarus thing. They, you know, Lazarus just sitting there, he's happy to be alive. Who was it? It was Vivian. Martha. And then all of a sudden, here she comes in, but Mary comes in with an alabaster box.
Yes.
Box on, breaks. Now, I'm going to preach this. I'm going to preach on this. What's the last thing you gave? I don't know. That may have been the very last thing she was ever able to give her. And I got to think this morning, I said, I thought, preacher, what's the last thing you gave? I prayed for my family this morning, prayed for the church, prayed for me, prayed for my Bud. I didn't come up here just half-hearted. What was the last thing you gave to him? Not what I do for him, but what was the last thing I gave him?
Mm-hmm.
This morning, church, I'm trying to challenge your heart. We call it revival. We ought to call it attempt. We're going to attempt to have revival.
Amen.
Because it all is dependent on our response to the gospel. the word that way. Soul after soul after soul. And can I say something, and I'm just going to give you this little thought. It amazes me that the great white throne judgment, do you notice the one pinnacle thing that the Lord did before he started the great white throne judgment? You know what it was? Go back to verse number, is it verse number 10? Revelation 20? And the devil that deceived them was cast into the lake of fire and brimstone. You know what God did? He knew every unrepentant sinner, the first person they would want him to see.
Oh, yeah.
He removed that excuse. He had the books there that showed the deeds of the life. I'm not talking about always the good things, but see, the deed is not necessarily the good action, but the deed will testify of the motive behind it.
Right.
A lot of people do good things, but they do it because of a perverted motive.
Yes.
Amen. I know preachers in the pulpit today doing what they're doing, they're perverted in their motive.
Right.
Amen. And then he's got the Book of Life. He's got three substantial testimonies there. He eliminated that. Nobody can blame Satan. He's holy and righteous. Nobody can accuse him of false judgment because the books are there. And then the book that records the redeemed is there. There's three testimonies there.
Yes.
I can't deny. This morning, I don't care if you're the youngest teenagers and the oldest adult here. Every one of us can't say that we've got people that we know if they took their last breath and held it. He's walking. He said, preach what he said. I'm saying this. Well, ask God in this meeting. Well, ask God. I don't want to be that carnal Christian. I'm not that lost Christian. I mean, I'm not that lost, that person who professes Christ and truly lost.
Right.
And I'm not that person. I have Christ in the heart and saved. And I don't want to be that carnal Christian. I am too much. I don't want to be, but I am too much. But I want to be that spiritual man. Amen. And like you said, Bridge, I want to lead my family. I don't want to just point my family and tell them what to do. I want to show them how to do it. I want to show them how to love God. I want to show them how to be faithful. I want to show them how to be true. I wonder who cried when Jesus died. But Richard, you kind of hit your bow, eyes closed.